The spirit of poverty has been over the valley like a dark cloud, and we believe that God is telling us that it's time to take it back.
If we could just share a little happiness with those that's maybe less fortunate than we are, that's worth it all.
Lord Jesus done what he done for all of us, and all we got to do is accept it.
That's right.
And live day by day.
That's what you people are doing. You're coming out here and you're interacting with people and you're showing that little light, and we're seeing it in that tunnel.
That's what I hope, that what they see is that people love them and that God loves them too. I hope that through us that they saw Jesus in us.
Hi, I'm Dante Thompson, president of Dub Broadcasting. And every year since 1980, we've been visiting the Appalachian Mountains. We always try to choose the communities that are in bad economic and spiritual needs. This year, we decided to go to McDowell County, West Virginia. We had been to McDowell County previously in 2009, which was also my mother's last trip.
This used to be the richest county in the state of West Virginia. Now it's the poorest county and the forgotten county.
I had never seen such poverty as there is here in McDowell County. I believe some people say it's the poorest county in the country. When people don't have hope, they turn to something, and I suppose that drugs is where they go. No hope.
Now meth is coming along, and cocaine and heroin and all of this stuff.
We have that problem everywhere. It's everywhere. It's not one particular city or one particular town. It's everywhere.
The children is the ones that's being neglected. Oh, it tears my heart apart, you know, because you don't want to see children suffering. And children is suffering from minor nutrition. If you're hungry, it won't allow you to learn. You know, it won't allow you to concentrate because your mind is on, I'm hungry.
Many health problems, many children born with birth defects. Maybe it's soil contamination from old mercury that was left from the mining days. I don't know what it is, but many, many health problems.
We always work with local pastors and social workers to help identify needy families in the community. And we always throw a big party on Sunday for at least 2,000 people. But we also take about 6 to 8 families every year with really needy situations and provide those needs for them as well. Every October, we send a team up to start the groundwork and meet families. It's a 3-day trip in the hills and hollers of West Virginia, and you never quite know what to expect when you get there.
The first family that we visited this year was the Collison family. They have 4 children, ages 4 to 9 years old, and they're expecting a new baby girl named Aubrey this month. They live in a small house that members of the community helped them build. We got to spend time with the children, see the house, and their new puppies. It was a lot of fun. Cheyenne likes to give really big bear hugs, and those hugs can almost be as strong as a man, surprisingly. It was so sweet because all of the children were so open to hugging us and loving on us, even though they didn't know us. The mom, Amy, was also very sweet. Even though they may not be in the best place to have another child, she truly loves her children. You can tell that she believes that all you need is love to bring a child into this world, not all the fancy things that we might have in this day and time.
So our second family, the friend family, their house caught on fire, I believe it was a couple months back. So now the family is still living in this home that essentially should be condemned.
She said, "Honey, I don't want to startle you, but your house is on fire." Mm-hmm. I said, I was getting ready to start panicking. Mm-hmm. Everything just rushed through your head because I had two kids here. Mm-hmm. And I was like, "Oh God, I got to find out something." She said, "Well, pick up the phone and call the house." I called the house, no answer. Mm-hmm. I called up my Uncle Bobby's and Aunt Cheryl's, and they told me that there's smoke rolling from my herbarium. Mm-hmm. I said, thank you, and I hung the phone up. My daughter said, "What's going on, Mommy?" I said, the house is on fire. Got in the truck, I went and went across the bridge, and this dude stood right there in my way. I didn't know. I was telling him, I said, my house is on fire. I gotta go. But they wouldn't let us come up here until all it was out and everything.
They're living in this home trying to fix it little by little, bit by bit. Apparently this fire only burned two rooms of this house, but the amount of water that it took to put the fire out damaged the entire house.
It hadn't cooled off really. It was still steaming when I started cleaning it out. I know if I didn't get the remnants of what was left and all that water and that insulation up.
Yeah, we come up here.
There wouldn't be nothing to rebuild. Now we're just fighting the winter. We got to get insulation up and get these ceilings up. If we don't get them up, it's going to get cold because all of our heat goes up. You know, we've got no way of containing it. Mm-hmm. It's going to, any place it finds a crack, it's going to look like steam outside there trying to, you know, heat the world up. Mm-hmm. And we got our hands full. The bottom line is what I worked out is what we live on now. And I go out here and subsidize with small jobs to make that back up. So it makes it hard on not only me, but everybody I touch. Mm-hmm. My children, my grandchildren, my sisters, and it affects everybody.
I spent the majority of my time with a little three-year-old little girl named Nevaeh, and my little girl's three. So it just made a connection there. And so I spent my time with Nevaeh just playing with her Dora Valentine's cards where we would count the hearts. And so I don't believe that she has any toys to play with. And that broke my heart. At one point when I asked her about a toy, she went and got her Hello Kitty blanket, which she's proud of. She loves it. But it broke my heart to see this little three-year-old living in this situation.
They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes.
And so when it was about time to leave, I told her that I was going to have to leave. And she said, "No, you can't leave." I said, "Well, baby, I have to leave." I said, "But I'll be back in a couple of weeks." And she just looked at me and said, "No, you won't." And that broke my heart because that shows me a little girl who has been let down so many times already in her small little life. And so at that point in time, she disappeared off of the stairs because we had been in the stairway this whole time. She disappeared off the stairs, and when I came downstairs, I heard her crying. But it broke my heart to leave that home tonight, knowing that poor little girl has already just seen so many disappointments in life, is what it seems like to us.
I want to help you. I'll see you soon.
Two of the children have a disability. One baby, 2 years old, will never be able to walk, talk. He can move his arms, but that's it. That's all he can do. But I smiled at him and picked at him, and he just grinned at me, just so precious, just precious. And my heart was just breaking when I saw that little child. He was beautiful. He looked like a little angel.
The third family we visited was the George Mitchell family. Their house was in pretty bad shape, and their only income comes from George, from the money that he makes from doing odd jobs. He also makes some money by collecting and selling plants that have grown in the hills for ages, something that his grandmother taught him as a young boy.
We'd go out in the mountains and she'd tell us, y'all boys dig me up a little handful of that and bring it back to her. We'd take it back to her because her stomach was messed up. She'd boil it on the stove and make yellow root tea out of it, she called it. But she never did get sick after she drank that though. Mm-hmm. That's what they call the yellow root.
Because it's real yellow.
So the little, those are the
parts where the tops come off. I mean, the tops come up.
Mm-hmm.
Grows. There's ginseng.
Collecting herbs and doing a few handyman jobs isn't enough to support a family of four. So we made plans to come back around Christmas with groceries and Christmas gifts to make it a little bit brighter.
We went to the Sterling restaurant and met with three of the eight locals that we'll be working with. Some of them are pastors, some of them are community leaders, some of them are missionaries within these communities, and they all do different stuff to help people in this community. And so we met with them just to let them know what our project is about and what we'd like for them to help us do. And so we'll be giving them tickets to pass out in their community to people to allow them to come to our Christmas party. So we hope to reach several different towns to this party, which will be an amazing accomplishment.
Well, we'll make a lot of good contacts with families and with other church groups, because we are going to reach out to other nonprofits and churches in the area that will all come together while you guys are here for your Christmas party, and we will continue those relationships with the churches and nonprofits after you guys have gone.
It's a wonderful thing to do, something for the Lord, something for the community. So that's a great feeling. It's a great feeling.
We had a young lady yesterday. She said she was just delighted that we had already contacted her about the program, because she's been looking forward to working with other nonprofits and other church groups.
It gives a really good door opening. These gifts that you would give help us be able to break that barrier into their lives and provide a simple toy or a blanket or some food to a family who doesn't have much. Provides an inlet into their lives so that we can share about Christ. Why are we giving gifts? Because Jesus Christ gave his life as a gift for us.
One exciting thing about this trip is we had a chance to revisit a family that we had previously visited in 2009, the Joe Mitchell family. Joe had a rough past, but he had found the Lord back in 2009, a few months before we visited for the first time. Christina was able to sit down and talk to his wife and daughter.
The interview with the Mitchell family was actually very happy. There was a few times where we talked about maybe their past and her husband's drug use, but they try to look towards the future. They don't like to look back into their past. They feel like God wiped that away. They have a daughter named Tamara that's 13 now. And she is the funniest little girl, funniest teenager. You don't normally see teenagers this happy and joking around with us, and she truly did that. She wanted to show us all of her animals. They have a miniature farm at their house, and she wanted to show us all of her animals, including the ferret that Margaret was deathly scared of.
They had a ferret that I refused to look at because it reminds me of a rat. And so I turned my back on that. I didn't want to see that. But they were a very happy family. And they are Christians. And they said there was no church close around anymore, that they had all closed up. And I know when I was talking with the pastor at one of the churches today, he said that a lot of people are moving away.
Most of the doors are shutting down.
Really?
Mm-hmm. So we watched Joseph Prince and a lot of the preachers on the TV and stuff and everything. And
their living conditions isn't like what we would expect living conditions to be, but they're actually happy. And I contribute that to the fact that they have joy in their life, and they feel like they know who brings that joy to them, and that's Jesus Christ.
A lot of people's asking us, how can we live the way we do and everything? And I told them, I said, give your life to the Lord and just let Him take care of everything for you. Before I got saved, I mean, a lot of people didn't even want to be around me. I was just so evil before I got saved. And then after I got saved, it's like peace come over me. And it's really been good.
We had two final families to visit with before we headed back to Greenville to get busy, to get everything ready for Christmas. The Mullins family was led by two grandparents, and in addition to their other grandchildren, they were raising a special needs grandchild named Angel.
She's a special needs child, and she's the apple of my eye. And she is so sweet. She make your life worth living. She been in the room 2 days when I was sick. She been back there with me. So she is a good little girl. She does a whole lot. Now I'm gonna tell you the story of this. The reason this baby is like this. Her mama took her to North Carolina. She let her get a hoe to 3 lines of coke. And it stopped her from breathing, but her brother was there and he got her back to breathing. That's how she's in that shape. Many a days I sit and I cry because of seeing what they had reduced her to. And that, you know, to me, that just wasn't cool, because this baby, she used to run, eat, feed herself, run up and down the steps, and then she come back and she was like it. And it took some time getting used to that. And still, sometime, I'm still thinking about it.
So it's just 7 days a week, 24 hours, and you're here with four, not just Angel, but with three more children, taking care of them.
I raise all of them. I get up every morning, get all of them out for school, get them ready for school, and we get along pretty good. My health is not good. I have diabetes, high blood, and stuff like it. I be sick, but I try not to be because of the kids, especially this one. It's gonna be tight this year because we just had to get a car. We just had to knuckle down and get a car because we have so many appointments. So I have them Beckley, Princeton, Bluefield, and so we just had to just buckle down and get us a car.
We saw the need that this family had and promised to return at Christmas with some gifts and food for them to help them through a tough winter. At this point, we only had one family left to visit, and luckily for us, they were only a few streets away in the neighborhood. This family was headed by a young lady. There were three children. She was working in a nursing home as a CNA to provide for her family. After hearing her story and visiting with the children for a little while, it was time for us to get back on the road home to Greenville to start preparing for the big trip in December.
We accept financial and material donations all throughout the year, but October is really the kickoff for the Appalachian Christmas Project. Every year we need toys, bicycles, food, clothes, blankets, and anything else that a family can need. Our viewers in the upstate of South Carolina, North Carolina, and Georgia have always been loyal supporters of our missions projects. And these projects could never happen without them. As we get into the first week of December, we start loading the trucks, and the last week before we leave is always crazy.
Well, right now the guys are loading up the truck with food boxes that will go to the families at the Christmas party. I know that the last count there was about 200 food boxes. So in one box will go to each family. And some families have, you know, 4 or 5 kids in them.
We are on the truck loading up all the fruit bags for the Appalachian trip. We are just trying to get everything loaded and ready to go up there so many people get blessed.
For the most part, we are almost done. We are loading up our equipment and any last minute things we need for the parties. And Margaret is finishing up all of the final paperwork that we need to take on the trip with us.
We always take at least one 48-foot trailer full of toys and clothes, and then our Isuzu box truck full of family stuff, television equipment, and then our big van full of all the workers. And we always take at least 2 26-foot Penske's, one full of toys and clothes, and here lately, one packed full of bicycles.
Tell me about the bicycles.
Well, I've worked on 90, so we've got 60 new ones, so we've got the 150 on the truck now. Well, we lay them, the big ones down and put a 2x4 bracing under the frame part, keep from warping the wheels, and then we lay plastic between each bicycle and start stacking them up.
Anytime you're working for the Lord, the devil's going to try to intervene. A few days before we left for the trip, our missions director and my aunt, Margaret Rainey, had a personal tragedy.
What is going to make this trip hard for me this year is that my mom passed away this morning at 7:15. And my brother and my sister-in-law, and we talked, and my brother said my mama would be upset if she thought that she had kept me from going on this trip. And so I had prayed about it and thought about it, and so as a family, we made this decision for me to go ahead and go. And I know God will be with me, and I know my mom, some way or another, will be there with me too. She was a precious, precious lady. One of the best moms that anybody in this world could ever have, and I'm so thankful to God that He did bless me with such a wonderful mom.
Lord, I thank you for the privilege, Father, that you've given us, Lord, to help.
Thursday finally came, and we all prepared to leave the station early in the morning. But before we go on any trip, we always start it with prayer. As we headed up the road, the weather went from warm and rainy to cold and rainy, and we had to wonder if the weather would continue like this for the whole trip. We arrived in Princeton, checked into the hotel, and we were immediately back on the road to pick up groceries and start our family visits. Our first family visit was with the Collison family, which had grown larger since our last visit.
When I went into the family, of course, the first thing I wanted to do was see the baby. Precious, precious little thing. They were all excited. They were excited over their gifts. And of course, I mean, they were really excited over the baby. I mean, they were thrilled to death over the baby. The dad just works part-time as a cleaner because that's the only thing he could find to do was to clean. And I think he has other little things maybe that he can do, you know, to get income coming in. And of course, the mother with 5 children, a mother can't work and, you know, take care of 5 children. You could tell that they all love each other. The mom and dad were, you know, just smiling at each other. And So you could tell that there was a lot of love in that home.
It was getting pretty late by the time we arrived at the George Mitchell house. The children ran out to greet us, and we caught up with the family a little. We shared about Jesus and gave them all a bunch of Christmas gifts.
Lord, I thank you for the George Mitchell family. And I ask you, Father, you would be with them, Father. Lord, that you would meet every need that they would have, God, in their lives. Well, I hope that they will realize that what we brought was from the Lord, to show the love of the Lord to them, that Jesus cares no matter what condition we're in, that Jesus cares, that He loves them, and that we love Him, love them too, because we are supposed to love everybody. As Christians, we are supposed to love everybody. And so, and that's what I hope, that what they see is that people love them and that God loves them too, and they can see that. I hope that through us, that they saw Jesus in us. Well, we wish y'all a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
We thank y'all very much.
Oh, you're welcome.
And we thank you, viewers. And
thank you. Appreciate it so much.
We've got a 99 Isuzu box truck, and it's been okay. It's got 60,000 miles on it because we hardly use it. We use it for Appalachia and then the pre-trips and stuff for Appalachia. And original alternator, I reckon, and it decides to die an hour and a half away from here with all of our equipment on it, all the family stuff on it, and out in the middle of nowhere.
What's going on?
We lost the battery. Right out, died.
It had a malfunction.
Luckily, Jack had jumper cables, and we just got a new van at the station, and we had to move their jumper cables from the old van to the new van, so we were unprepared. And but anyway, we got it started up, and the headlights weren't working, and that's scary because it's raining, it's dark, it's cold, and we're on hilly roads that we don't know. And the speed limit up here is interesting. The speed limit on these roads are 55 miles an hour. I'm in this van, and I'm not doing over 40. And if I'm doing 40, I'm terrified. So I can imagine how you felt in the Isuzu with no lights on. Fun times.
We are driving through the West Virginia mountains with no headlights because they are shorting out along with most of the other electrical things in this truck.
That's why it's so dark.
Yeah.
Up there.
Yeah.
Usually, you know, when you're driving, you'd be able to see the road and other objects in front of you. But we are currently unable to do that, which I think violates some sort of law.
Oh yeah, we're definitely breaking at least a South Carolina law. I'm gonna guess it's probably a West Virginia law as well.
This morning, after Tim locked the keys in the truck with the bicycles on it, we had to drive the box truck with the bicycles on over to where the other Isuzu was that has the dead alternator, unload the bicycles, which we were going to have to do anyway, and then unload all of our equipment and all of our family stuff onto the big Penske.
What we do with our bicycles is we give them to the person that helps us oversee the project here in the community. And that person will identify some of the most neediest families that have children who might would like a bicycle for Christmas. And so they'll identify those families and they'll give those families those bicycles for Christmas.
We stopped by the grocery store again for food for the evening's families. We always make a lot of grocery shopping trips as some of the families have a lot of children. It was getting cold and rainy when we got to the house of the Friend family. We didn't really know what to expect when we went up the hill.
They have done a lot of work on their home. I noticed sheetrock was put up, and there was a washing machine and a dryer that someone had donated. They are so optimistic, you know, about it. And they're excited that they have gotten as much done as they have. They were real excited about it. And it's just gonna take time, basically, for them to get things fixed up.
After visiting the Friend family for the second time, I felt a little better leaving the home. It really seems like David, the father, is really trying to work hard for his family, really trying to put this house back together.
Tell me about the progress that has happened since the last time we've been here. What all has happened?
Oh, we got the ceilings up in here. We got the ceilings up in there. We got a lot done. He's still got to do a lot more. It's taking a toll on us. But we're working it out, though, you know. It takes time.
We're able to talk with Jessica a little while about each of the children. She was able to share some joy with us and the work that had been accomplished and how they had started finally receiving some assistance for Isaiah, the two-year-old, who sadly it took them 2 years to be able to even get assistance just because of where they live.
Hello, I'm Isaiah Friend. I'm the boss around here. This is the boss.
We were able to see Miss Nevaeh again, and she's been a little bit sassy tonight, but I like being able to see that because I know the last time she just seemed to be a little sad the last time I saw her, so it was good to see her be a little more up in spirits. The Friend family didn't open their presents when we saw them today. And Mom asked if we could wait to let them open them until Christmas Day because she wasn't sure if she'd be able to get them anything else for Christmas.
I hope that they see the love of Jesus also. I don't think that they are Christians, but I hope that, you know, through this, that they will see how many people have helped them and donated things. And maybe that will bring them to the realization that other people love them and care for them, and that God loves them too, and is concerned about every one of them.
Dear Father, we just thank you for allowing us to be here today and with this family, with the Friend family. We pray that you'll continue to have your hand on each one of the children's lives, that you'll help the parents make decisions for their children that are positive for their future. And Father, we just pray that as they continue to move forward, that each one of them will just continue to remember the love that you have for them, Father. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. We love you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Friday night, we met with the volunteers to organize things for the party on Sunday. It's always great to see a community come together to help bring Christmas to their own less fortunate. After we ironed out details, we ended up the meeting with prayer.
Believing and trusting upon your holy word. And you, Lord, you said before one jot or one tittle of your word shall fail, that heaven and earth would pass away. So, Lord God, we're just standing on your promises today. Lord.
We revisited the Mullins family a little afternoon. And Angel was doing a little better, but she was still having trouble with seizures.
Since y'all was here last, Angel had a grandma seizure, and it stopped her from breathing for 30 seconds. And then I rubbed on her, got her back. Then she was getting ready. The doctor had released her. She's coming home. And they put something on her finger. It went off and started beeping. And she had another seizure, so it knocked her out. So we went and got the doctor, and he said, no, we're not going to send her home. We're going to send her to Charleston. So we stayed over Charleston overnight with her, and she still have many seizures, but they're not bad, but they do make her tired and make her go to sleep. I just hope my Heavenly Father will give me the grace and bless me to be here, to see her, you know, get up on her own a little. So that, you know, we trying to learn her different things to do. And she's doing pretty good because now she gets so, she would say some things, but now she getting so she'll talk. She'll call me Mama, and she'll say Mama all the time sometime. Mm-hmm. And when Papa gone, she'll say, "Poor Papa."
Aww.
And you know, for a while she wasn't doing that. And now she's got another teacher, and this teacher is really working with her. And you know, we give her a lot of praise because she's doing a whole lot with her.
Lord, we thank you, God, that we have this honor and this privilege, Lord, to be in this home with this family. And Father, I thank you for these grandparents, Lord, that love these children enough, Lord, that they wanted them to come and be with them so they could take care of them. And Lord, for little Angel, Father, we're just believing that you're going to perform a miracle in her, because God, you made our bodies, and Lord, you can heal them and you can fix them. And so I pray for this whole family, God, that you would touch each one of them, Lord, that you would be with them, God, that you would take care of them. And Father, we're going to give you praise. We're going to give you glory, Father, for this family and for what you're going to do. In Jesus' blessed name I pray. Amen.
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 I thank God up above for y'all. Because if it weren't for these programs, I'm going to tell you now, my kids wouldn't have a good Christmas. Now, they usually have a decent Christmas. But this year, we have been through so much and spent so much going back and forth to the hospital, and we just couldn't do it. We do, you know, a few things, but other than that, no. And I thank God up above for y'all, and I thank him for the blessings that we receive from him each and every day. Thank y'all. Well, thank you.
Have a Merry Christmas.
We had one last stop at yet another grocery store and two more families to visit. The temperatures were dropping rapidly, and it looked like snow might be moving in.
How's the temperature?
It's cold. Getting colder.
We're doing good. We're freezing. Freezing, I say. Power went out while we were grocery shopping, so the only thing you could pay with was cash. So, yeah. Power went out. Luckily, we were already done shopping and in line, checking out.
I've never been in a parade before.
This year was the first year that we got to be in an actual Christmas parade in the town. Well, we weren't actually invited. We kind of got stuck behind a fire truck with Santa Claus in it, but I took advantage of the opportunity and decided to wave to the people myself.
We stopped and talked to Maurice, who had come back to West Virginia to help out his family, who had been going through a difficult time. There were numerous grandchildren and cousins living in a very small house.
Well, I grew up in this community and in Welch, West Virginia. It's like 3 or 4 miles down the road from here. And it's a small community, and it's hard to find good jobs around here and stuff. The coal mine used to be big and the railroad, but things are really slow about getting a good job. And I'm just so proud of my daughters working so hard to take care of the families, because in this area, a lot of people don't have a complete family, just trying to make ends meet, one person working. And I'm just so proud of my daughters, how hard they work to take care of their brothers and sisters and stuff. They've got a very strong love for each other. And I don't think anything could break it. We're just a close-knit family. We try to come together in tough times. If somebody's you know, having a tough time that doesn't live right here in the area, we all try to get together and you know, go out to see about the ones that's having, you know, whatever the situation might be. That we try to look out for each other, be there for each other. It's the way family should be. Isn't it?
Can we pray with y'all? And,
yes.
You know, just ask God to continue to touch y'all's family and bless y'all's family. You know, we believe in a God that can meet all of our needs. He never says that we're going to have things perfect. You know, we know that we're going to go through tough times. We're going to have good times as well. But we just ask that God will continue to touch and bless the family. So do you mind?
We thank you for that. Let's pray.
Dear Father, we just thank you for allowing us to come into this home today. We thank you for allowing us to be able to meet each one of these family members. They seem like such a close-knit family. And Father, we just pray that you continue to allow them to stay close. We ask that you continue to touch this family and bless this family in ways that we cannot foresee. We ask that you touch each one of these children's lives, that they will go on to grow up and do the work of the Lord, that they will make something of themselves along with these this positive reinforcement that is in their life. They seem like they have such a strong family background. So just touch each person's life individually and collectively as a family. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 We are very blessed to be interviewed by you guys, and we thank y'all for coming by and wishing y'all the best for the holidays, and ask God to bless y'all and keep y'all safe with what y'all doing and the good things that y'all doing. Ask God to help y'all continue.
The last family of the trip was the Joe Mitchell family. I had only missed one trip to Appalachia in probably 10 years or more, and that was in 2009 because of my firstborn child, Riley. But 2009 was also my mother's last trip to Appalachia, and where she interviewed Joe Mitchell and first met Joe Mitchell, and they talked about his salvation that took place just a few months prior to them first meeting. So in last year, when we went back to meet Joe Mitchell, I was looking forward to hearing about his progression with his walk with Christ.
I was pretty wild when I was in school.
What were you doing?
Smoking weed.
Smoking weed.
I've always been a pothead. I get up every morning time, fire me one up. I used to ride horses and saddle my horse up and take off. And I'd smoke weed all day long.
Now didn't I'd you get back. Tired of that life?
Well, that was the only life I chose at that time. My mother passed away, and that was the only comfort that I found. The only way I could deal with it.
Just but living something it happened up. To you. What was it?
Well, the good Lord got a hold of me.
Okay, tell me about the day or night that you found Jesus.
Okay, I was sitting right there where you at.
This chair.
About 5:30 in the morning.
Good night.
I had a 20-gauge shotgun hanging on the wall, and I thought about just ending it.
The shotgun was calling.
The more I looked at that, the worse it got. Yeah, come on, go ahead, do it. Well, I was just flipping through the channels, and this little preacher from Arkansas was on there reading about the Bible. And by the time his hour was up, I was crying and feeling good. So that day, that morning, I asked the Lord to come into my life then. And it's been a good ride since.
How long has it been?
7.5 months ago.
Has home been different, Tammy?
It's been wonderful. Getting rid of St. Elmo's life has been the best decision we made, bringing the Lord into it.
That's great. That's great.
I want to thank you, Joe, for having us here at your house. We were here about 3 years ago. My mother was here. That was down the mountain a little ways, wasn't it?
Yeah, down at the bottom of the road.
And you got a good-looking barn you're working on. You got your ponies up here. Tell us about these ponies you got.
Little blonde-headed one is a Rocky Mountain Gray. Mm-hmm. And the little black one's a little mare, Jim. She's bred by the little blonde-headed one. They gentle on the kids a lot.
That's good.
Except the little stud, he's mean. Gonna break him.
Yeah.
So that's about it on them.
Well, how's things? You still working and stuff since we've been here last?
Yeah, the same that I've always done. Just had to slow down a little bit. Had doctors to tell me I had to quit altogether, not do nothing. But now you can listen to mankind, or you can listen to your heart and follow the Lord. So take it as it comes to you.
Yeah.
So you do what you like. Mm-hmm. So that's what I do.
Good. You still in church?
Not as much as I want to be. There is no churches around here to go to.
I didn't see many coming in.
You can see probably two or three, and the doors are closed.
When we were here last, you would tell my mother that you got saved watching Christian television, right?
Yeah.
Watching a preacher. So you still can get Christian television up here, can't you?
Yeah.
That's good.
And I still do that every day.
Good. Good. That's wonderful.
I'd watch with Joseph Prince.
Mm-hmm.
And then every now and then when I get hungry, I just watch whatever pops up through there.
That's good. I like that when I get hungry.
When my soul wants it, well, you got to feed it.
Exactly.
And that's what I do.
Yeah.
You know, other people may and may not, but I do. It makes me feel good. So if I feel good, I guess the good Lord feels good.
That's it. We're here to praise Him, and we can't do that if we're down and out, can we?
No. I always said it take a hard time to be a Christian, but I was wrong. It's the easiest thing you ever want to do, because there's nothing to it. The Lord Jesus done what He done for all of us, and all we got to do is accept it.
That's right.
And live day by day.
Exactly.
Our sins is forgotten, present, past, and future. Mm-hmm. All sins are forgotten.
And isn't that a peaceful knowledge? You know, you have that peace about it. That you, when you die, you're going to go to heaven. And that's just
yeah.
A peaceful thing.
It's got to make you feel good.
Yeah.
And if it don't, then something wrong with you.
Exactly.
But I feel good.
Good, good. Well, thank you so much for letting us come up here.
Well.
All the viewers, you know, we've been coming to the Appalachian Mountains for Dub Broadcasting House for over 30 years, and we never have checked in on a family before that we've visited in the past. I'm honored that we were able to check in on you today and see how you're doing. I'm glad you're still looking up. That's encouraging. It really is.
Well, tell any of them out there, come on out here and meet this old hillbilly.
He'll tell you about Jesus, that's for sure.
Yeah. Tell them they got a friendly face out here. Come on out here.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Excellent.
I put them to work.
I can see
that. I need some help. Ain't got nobody out here.
That's fun.
Give them something to do.
That's fun. Right. Well, we brought you some groceries and some clothes and thanks for Christmas. And it's going to be Christmas before you know it here, isn't it?
Yeah.
It feels like it tonight. We're supposed to get snow and ice tonight. Well, let's go inside where it's warm. That's exciting.
All right.
Everything froze Saturday night, so Sunday morning required a bit of ice removal before we could get started.
Is that a lot of things?
$7 for something to scrape the ice off? No, not when I got a Microtel key card that doesn't work. And on the way to Welch, where the Christmas party was going to be, we started getting rain and sleet. It's about an hour drive from the hotel to the location, and the roads were starting to get bad, but our spirits were high for the highlight of the trip. There are always a few unforeseen issues that arise.
I don't know, somebody got stuck. I guess Catlin got stuck trying to get the big trailer in, and then Chan had to pull him out already, and then now he doesn't think he can move with the trailer on there, so Chan's gonna pull him with the little truck. It's gonna be fun.
Mm-hmm.
now we just keep on trucking.
Yeah. People started lining up outside despite the rain, and we let them in a little early to dry off and stay warm. The children are always so excited to see the toys, but first we had some music and most importantly, a Sunday message.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
Oh, that's a blessing. That's a blessing to have, be able to talk to so many people about the love of Jesus. And just to look out and see so many people that you could witness of the goodness of Jesus. It's fantastic, fantastic.
If it had not been for Jesus, where would we be today? We would still be walking around in darkness. And God wants us to let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works, that we might glorify our Father which is in heaven. Salvation is free. He said, ask and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find, and knock and the door shall be opened unto you. And if you're here today and Jesus has not came into your life, to let that light in you shine for him, today is your day.
Wade Hall led many in the audience through the salvation prayer.
Heavenly Father, Lord, I'm here just as I am. Lord, I recognize that I don't know you as Lord and Savior. Lord, I ask you right now to forgive me, Lord, of all my faults, my failures, my sins, dear Lord.
It is always wonderful to see so many people dedicate or rededicate their lives to Jesus. And this makes a trip like this always worthwhile.
If you'll ask that of him each and every day, he'll be there. A new day for you. Now let's give the Lord a big hand clap. Now I've got a question. Are there any young people here that would like some toys? Wow. I say it again, holler out loud. Are there any young people here that would like some toys?
It means a lot to them. It really helps out hundreds of families out there that really needs the help, that ain't got the money or anything to buy Christmas presents, and it really helps them out a lot. And they appreciate it tremendously.
Because I know that we have a lot of needy people in McDowell County, and this is a blessing that you all came down to give our clothes, and I want to help.
Oh, it's absolutely awesome. Very rewarding. Seeing kids' faces, I mean, they light up, they see toys, they get what they want. Just seeing God work through the volunteers, seeing just the blessings that are being given to these people, it's awesome. It's absolutely awesome.
Today, I heard many people tell me that, you know, this is going to be their Christmas. And to be a part of that and know I can walk away and know that there's some warm homes, children with smiles on their faces, it means a lot.
Man, it's been a busy day, but we had a great crowd, and I am so tickled to death that we were able to help as many people as we have today. Be honest with you, I am wore out, but I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world, and I thank God that y'all allowed me to be a part of this. God just keeps getting better and better every year about serving people and helping people with their needs.
I hope that they're left to know that Jesus loves them, and that other people, not just in West Virginia, but also in Greenville, South Carolina, and the surrounding areas of Greenville, that people love them, that don't even know them, but they care and they love them.
I hope we brought a little joy and a little happiness to some of the homes and into some of the hearts. You know, if we could just share a little happiness with those that's maybe less fortunate than we are, then that's worth it all. You know, then if we can bring Jesus into their life, you know, and let them know that He does, He's there, and He does love them. You know, when they feel like it's they're down and out and nobody cares, He's there and He cares for them.
I want to personally thank each and every one of you for making this trip possible. Without your love and support, none of these trips that we do here at Dove Broadcasting would be possible. We are just the tool that you send to go and do these things. You are the backbone. You are the person that's doing it, and you are responsible in God's eyes for these trips. Every salvation that we come into is because of you, the person who sends us on these trips. And again, I know this year will be no different. You're going to continue to support Dove Broadcasting and all the missions trips, especially Appalachia.